Hi everyone! Have you been studying the Laplace transform? Here's a new video with exercises that we will solve together, and I'm sure this will help you clarify some of the doubts you may have. I'm Gio, an assistant professor at UPF in Barcelona. On my channel I upload theory and tutorial classes on signals and systems, and this is the right channel for you to learn the basics very quickly. So are you ready? Let's get started with today's exercises. The first exercise is about some RLC circuit where we're given the relation between input and output. Okay, so this is given by a differential equation of the second order. And we need to determine the relation between the parameters R, L, and C so that the step response of the system does not present any oscillation. So how do we do that? Let's write down the differential equation in the Laplace domain. So we transform both left and right hand side. We remember that the differentiation in time domain corresponds to a multiplication by the complex variable s in the Laplace domain. And here we get the corresponding equation, which is a polynomial in s of the second order. So h of s, which is the Laplace transform of the impulse response of the system, which is also called the system response, is obtained as y of s divided by x of s. So it's a ratio of polynomials. And in this case, we can find it compactly as 1 over LCS squared plus RCS plus 1. Okay. So if we want the system not to present any oscillation, then we need the poles, meaning the roots of the denominator of h of s, to be real. They must have no imaginary part, because it's the imaginary part, if you recall from theory classes, what causes the oscillations in the response. So we just go on and study the denominator of that fraction. We look at the roots of the denominator and we find two values for s. These will depend, of course, on the values of r, c, and l. And in order for those to be real, we want the content of the square root to be positive, okay? So we just impose that condition and we find that r has to be larger than twice the square root of l over c. The next exercise gives us four different second order differential equations that describe systems, in particular causal and stable systems. And we need to determine the transfer function h of s for these systems, and also whether the impulse response is underdamped, critically damped, or overdamped. So let's do that together. We start with the first one, which is part A. Again, I calculate the Laplace transform of both left and right hand side of the differential equation. Again, I recall that each differentiation in the time domain corresponds to a product by s, and here's the equation I get. So from that, I can obtain h of s as y of s over x of s. Again, it's a ratio of polynomials. In this case, it's a particularly simple one. It's given by 1 over s plus 2 squared, as you can see. So from that, we look at the roots of the denominator, or the poles. In this case, there's a single pole in s equal minus 2, and it's double. It means it has double multiplicity. That pole counts twice because the term is of the second order. There's a square, okay? So when we have two real poles and they are identical, then the system, if you recall from theory, is critically damped. In part B, we have a differential equation again, and again I calculate the Laplace transform of both left and right hand side, and again I get h of s, the response of the system, as the ratio between y and x. I look at the roots of the denominator, which are the poles, and in this case I find that the square root has a negative number inside. That means that the roots will be two complex and conjugate, okay? So there are two complex conjugate poles. That means that the system is underdamped. The one in part C, I do the same thing again. What am I gonna find this time? Well, in this case, h of s is 1 over s squared plus 20s plus 1. So I look at the roots, and the roots are going to be real, and but distinct in this case. There's two different roots. So if you remember, in the first case there were two real poles but they were identical. So in this case the system is overdamped. And finally, to conclude, in part D, again I have another simple second order differential equation. It's just a little bit longer here, so just a few more calculations, but the result is similar. I'm going to study the roots of the denominator, and I find that in this case there's a root of a negative number, which means that there's going to be some imaginary part. So I have two complex conjugate poles, and the system is under them again. So now let's move on to exercise 9. In this case, I'm giving a signal y of t, which is e to minus 2t u of t, okay? And this is the output of a causal all-pass system, for which the system function is given, and it's h of s equal s minus 1 over s plus 1, okay? So we ask to find and sketch two possible inputs, x of t that would produce that y of t, okay? And also we asked what the input x of t is, if it's known that x of t is absolutely integrable, okay? So let's go one step at a time. So here I'm just sketching our situation, which is we have a system with impulse response h of t. It takes an input x of t and produces an output y of t, okay? So in particular, the system we're given, the exercise says it's an all-pass system. What does that mean? Well, if you look at h of s and you calculate the magnitude, for example, you see that it's equally 1 for every value of s. So the system is all-pass. It means that it passes every frequency. It's not selective. It's not low-pass. It's not high-pass. It's not band-pass. It passes everything. It's all-pass. Okay. So now for part A, we need to find inputs x of t that produce that output y of t. So here's how I am operating. Y of t in the Laplace domain has a Laplace transform y of s. Okay, so I'm calculating the Laplace transform of y of t with the definition, which is the integral of y of t e to minus s t dt. Okay, so I'm just doing all the calculations here, and here's the result I find. I need to evaluate this between 0 and infinity. So in order to determine the convergence of that, I noticed that that 2 plus sigma has to be positive. That's the only way, such that when t is evaluated at plus infinity, the result converges. So from that, I obtain the condition for convergence and the region of convergence, therefore, which is that the sigma, or real part of s, equivalently, has to be larger than minus 2. And then the result is simply 1 over s plus 2. So let's just write that down. So y of s, the Laplace transform of the output, is 1 over s plus 2, and its regional convergence is real part of s larger than minus 2. Alright, so here I'm just representing what happens in the Laplace domain. It's just an equivalent representation. I have a black box, which is h of s. It's the Laplace transform of the impulse response, and it takes inputs x of s and produces outputs y of s. In the Laplace domain, of course, I don't have a convolution relationship between input and output, but I just have a simple product relationship. So if you remember, in the time domain, my y of t is the convolution between x and h. But in the Laplace domain, y of s is the product between x of s and h of s. So that means that I can recover x of s by calculating y of s over h of s. And here's its simple expression, okay? So it's going to be given by s plus 1 over s plus 2 times s minus 1. So now I can work on that to determine x of t. Remember, the exercise is asking for x of t. So let's sketch the possible regions of convergence of that. I need to know, if you remember, the region of convergence in order to be able to calculate the anti-Laplace transform. So there's several possibilities in this case. So I'm just going to list all of them. The first one is a region of convergence to the left of the pole in minus 2. Okay. The second one is a region of convergence between the two poles, the one in minus 2 and the one in plus 1. And the third option in blue is to the right of the pole in plus 1. Okay. But I know that y of s had a region of convergence to the right of minus 2. So this is incompatible with the option I marked in red. So I'm just going to get rid of that because that is not possible. I'm left with two possibilities, okay? The green one and the blue one. So let's go on and study them separately. I label them as number 1 and number 2. So before doing that, before calculating the anti-transform, I know that x of s in its current form, it's not really the best for me to do the anti-transform. I need to do a partial fraction expansion. So here's what I'm doing, and I'm going to determine the coefficients a and b as we usually do, okay? I equate that to the original expression, and I find two equations in two unknowns for a and b, and I keep going with the calculations until I find a and b. and I see that a is 3 and b is 2. So let's just go and replace those values. Okay, so I substitute that. So now I have a simple expression for x of s. It's the sum of two terms of the first order. I'm going to anti-transform each of them individually. So let's clean up a bit. And now let's take the first case first, okay? The first case, the one marked in green, is when real part of s is between minus 2 and plus 1. All right. So now I want to anti-transform each of the two first-order terms. I need to find out their respective regions of convergence, okay? So what can they be? I only have one option, as you can see. The first one on top, 3 over s plus 2, can be either to the left of minus 2 or to the right of minus 2. But I know that it has to be to the right of minus 2. There is no other option, okay? And regarding the second one, well, the second one has to be to the left of plus 1 because that's the only way compatible with the region of convergence, the overall region of convergence of x of s. So now I just take note of that, of those two regions of convergence, and I can anti-transform those terms individually. So let's just do that. The first one will give me a right-sided signal. So the anti-transform is 3e to minus 2t u of t. And the second one will give me a left-sided signal. So it's going to be minus 2e to the power of t u of minus t, okay? So now if I sum them up, then I have my x of t in this case, case number one, which is the green case for us, and I wrote it there on top. Now we clean up and we consider the second case, which is the blue one. In this case, the region of convergence, the overall one, is real part of s larger than 1. So what options do I have for the individual fractions? Well, the first one has to converge to the right, okay, and the second one too. So both of them are right half planes, and I just write the regions of convergence. So the anti-transforms have to be right-sided signals, and here they are, 3 to e to minus 2t u of t and 2 e to t u of t. So let's just write that down. Now we have found the two possible inputs, x of t, that could produce the y of t given by the exercise. Just to visualize them, we can sketch them, okay, just to see what they look like. So let's start with the first one in green. It's 3e to minus 2t u of t minus 2e to t u of minus t. So see, there's a part for positive times that is a decaying exponential, and there's another one for negative times that is also a decaying exponential, but, you know, mirrored for negative values. What about number 2? Well, I have two components. You see 3e to minus 2t u of t is a decaying exponential that starts at 3 and decays to 0. And the other one, 2e to the power of t, is a growing exponential that starts at 2 and grows to infinity. And the sum of them, I have marked it in a solid light blue line. Okay, it goes down a little bit, but then it goes up to infinity. Okay, now let's just move on to part B of the exercise, which is asking what is the input if I know that the input is absolutely integrable, okay? Now, basically, I have to choose between 1 and 2. So which one do you think is absolutely integrable? Well, obviously, it's 1, okay? But there's different ways of seeing that. For example, for me, I know that if x of t is absolutely integrable, then the region of convergence of its Laplace transform has to contain the j omega axis, okay? So that means that I'm in case number 1, okay? And therefore, here is the x of t I'm looking for. I can just verify that. I can verify if this is absolutely integrable. Obviously, number 2 is not absolutely integrable because it diverges to infinity. Let's verify that option 1 is, okay? So now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to explicitly calculate the integral of the magnitude of that, of the absolute value. So what is the absolute value? It's very easy to do that graphically. As you can see, there are two parts in this signal in green, and one is negative, and I just mirror it up, okay, because I take the absolute value, and the other one is positive. And so now I just rewrite the integral as running between minus infinity and infinity of the two parts. They both have step functions, so that helps me simplify the integrals. And so I have two simple integrals that I evaluate between 0 and infinity and minus infinity and 0. And the results are 3 over 2 and 2, respectively. The sum is 7 over 2, which is clearly bounded. Okay, so I have verified that that was the input I was looking for if I know that it has to be absolutely integrable. Right, so as promised, today we solved some new exercises on the Laplace transform together, and I hope this helps you understand this very important concept of signals and systems. Please go over the other exercise and theory videos and subscribe to this channel to be the first one to know when I upload something new. See you in the next video.